Hello and welcome to Onlandscape. My name's Tim Parkin and I have with me our regular, David Ward.
Good evening.
And we have special guest David Clapp.
Which makes you David Parkin.
I'm David Parkin for the day, honorary David, because we have David Hutchinson behind the video operator and another David Parkin operating the computer, sending questions and heckling from the background. That'd be my wife, David.
Which David were you talking to then?
Worrying, isn't it? We have a bit of a random discussion, I think, guided by your questions. You've sent in 17 questions, I think we have here. And we're going to go through these questions, answering them by both of our experts, and maybe meander off topic occasionally.
No.
He's breathing in, so does he. Oh.
Yes, we've got our heckler for that in the corner. But what I'd like to do first is ask you what you've been doing for the year so far. David Clapp.
Well, so far freezing to death in northern Finland and running a tour with Ashley Spencer.
It couldn't have been that cold.
It was unbelievably freezing cold. The coldest, we beat the world record, my personal record was minus 36 and it hit minus 38. Give or take the accuracy of the temperature on the van, of course.
Isn't that where your lungs start freezing?
Oh, I don't know, but certainly my hands started freezing, and at one stage I was getting bluer fingers on one hand than I was on the other because of keeping hand in left pocket and fingers on shutters and things like that. And I got back in the car and realised that my fingers were getting frostbite on the right side of my hand. And I had a situation where my thumbs got literally stuck to the back of the L bracket on my camera. So, memorable, happy times.
Nobody tried the tongue thing, did they?
Never lick a lamppost in those conditions. It's not good,
exactly. No. So, that was pretty hectic. Since I've been back, I've been doing all sorts of little bits, I guess. I've been doing a lot of image processing and stuff.
Yeah.
And usual administration stuff, just running a business and all that. So.
And why are you travelling to the north?
Well, I've been on an experiment at the moment, and I've been looking at film.
Really?
Or not. Yeah, I've been looking at film. And I've got a
from a distance.
From a distance, just the boxes.
Yeah,
in a room.
Well, you've got to take it easy. You don't want to rush into these things.
So basically, I've been looking at film and the look of film because I'm interested in the look of film. Now, I'm not one to worry too much about massive amounts of megapixels. I never really have been at the moment, and it's more about the look of how images are made using transparency film and negative, and just exploring those avenues. And I've got a friend called Tristan Campbell who lent me a 6x9 film camera, which was again a really interesting experiment, and I started playing around with that at home. But because of it being a complication of this, the camera, the film, and then scanning, I've just been trying to piece together
It's a different world, isn't it?
Oh, it's just an unbelievably different world.
Well, we'll come back to that because somebody's asked a little bit about film later on.
Yeah.
And Mr. Ward, you've been out and about, not so cold, but maybe a little bit more windy.
I've been. I ran a workshop with Joe up in Torridon, and we had 112 mile an hour winds the day we arrived, and no electricity at the place we were staying, so that was great. Cook breakfast for 10 people with no electricity. It was really, really nice and easy. But fantastic conditions, actually. Really, really good. Big, beefy snow showers coming through and rapid changes of light, and it was really, really interesting stuff. So, and then I went to the Auvergne in central France to do a recce for a possible workshop for next year.
And they've had too much snow, I believe, in France in the hills.
They've had quite a lot, yeah. They've had quite a lot. I mean, it was amazing conditions when we were there. Apparently, normally the snow arrives a little bit later, sort of March time. But we got, so there was only about, 40 centimetres, 50 centimetres of snow on the ground when we were there. But everything was coated in ice and snow, which was really fantastic, really interesting stuff, and nice quiet area. I mean, there's lots of skiers, but they stick on their bit.
Yeah.
There's lots of the rest of the mountains that photographers can explore, and it's really,
one,
really interesting.
One for next year.
Yeah, March next year. Yeah.
Lots of sort of high key shots you came back with.
Lots of high key shots. Yeah, but it's which was very, very interesting to do. We just had there was ice rime on a lot of stuff. We had ice crystals, maybe. I don't know, 4 centimetres long sometimes, growing off the trees.
Yeah.
What's nice is that you've got a real mixture of pine trees and deciduous trees, so you've got lots of different forms in there. And the wider landscape is very nice as well, big mountains. It goes up to 1,850 metres, I think.
That's good.
Yeah. So, yeah, that's what I've been up to.
Excellent.
Yeah.
Well, I've just come back from Iceland. I know everybody else is still out there, I believe.
You and your Iceland beard, look at you.
I know. Kiss your neck warm. You can dock your collar with your beard.
You can't stop now. It has to grow.
Yeah.
I don't know if anybody watches Fast and Loud, car program. The guy's got a nice beard.
Are you going to plait it?
My wife, David's looking over me there.
You're going to square it off at the bottom as well?
Square it off at the bottom.
Yeah, yeah, totally. Yeah.
Straighten it.
Sunglasses yeah. for the summer so you can drive around in your Chevy.
Yeah.
That's the one.
Yeah. No, it needs a hog.
Yeah, big Harley.
Yeah,
I think it needs trimming slightly. It is a bit sort of proper Viking at the moment. So it's going sideways as well, which I didn't realise beards did that. It's got down to a certain length and gone. Oh, I'm going to go over there.
Yeah. Mind of its own.
I am getting stuck to the cats now and again.
I've been trying really hard this week to get a beard. Like
yours,
just for this show.
We'll
bless.
Knit you one.
Knit me one.
A quick aside: conference videos. We now have. Put one of our conference videos free, and it's David Clapp's video online with the
you've
worst icon.
You've got to change the picture.
Is the picture bad, is it?
If I'm like this.
Yeah, that and the red trousers. Pink trousers, sorry.
I have not heard anything said against my pink trousers.
They're beautiful pink trousers. But anyway, David Clapp's video is free, and we're doing a special offer of, I believe, 35% off, which will make the price £12.95 for all the remaining videos. So we've got an offer for that, which is Onland35 is the code. You can go to the website, which is
streamscape.uk.
And there's a big link on the homepage. User code Onland35. You can also buy each individual video. So if you're interested in a particular one, they're £2.95 each. Just checking, yes, £2.95.
You might as well buy the lot, though.
Just buy the lot, yeah. I've got to say, it's not a lot of money.
I'm not on commission.
No. you take 50%
How does it feel to be discounted?
Great.
Remainder before you discount.
That's it.
Buy them. Buy them now. And we'll move on to the questions. We have a first question, which is what was the last image that made you go, wow? Is this Stephen McGill? And did you not watch when you asked it last time? Just checking. We've had this question last time, and it was Landscape Photographer of the Year.
Mark Littlejohn.
Mark Littlejohn's image.
Yeah, and...
Has it changed?
It's a different Mark Littlejohn image.
Really? He's doing well, isn't it?
Yeah. No, it's a picture he posted recently of... I think it's a beech wood, I think, with mist, and it's very sort of dark. And
panoramic. Look.
Yeah, panoramic, very dark and evocative, and yeah, really nice, actually, very nice. A difference from the usual sort of... reaching for superlative vistas that a lot of people do, and I think it's a fantastic image. Yeah, very good.
Excellent. What about yourself?
I'm racking my brains. I really am. Well, actually, some of the stuff you showed me the last couple of days. Well, the thing was, is that, you know, we get to see images all the time on websites or online, and you don't really get to see the overall size of it. And some of the scans that you've done of some of your shots from Awesome a couple of years ago were just absolutely spellbinding with huge pictures on a massive 30-inch.
They look good monitor. On a big screen, don't they?
Absolutely phenomenal. And the thing is you can't ever get that sense of appreciation from looking at these things online.
Not without a 5-foot print.
No, it's very difficult, isn't it?
Yeah, but it's just so overwhelming when you see things like that in colour. And we've been talking about this a lot over the last couple of days, and colour and separation and various other things that you're getting from the things that you're doing. Which has been really interesting. But I think I haven't seen anything particular that's made me stop in my tracks, but I've seen a lot of work overall from the last 4 days, I think, in particular, that's really impressed me. I got a really good friend, Tristan Campbell, who lives not too far away. In fact, it's the first time I've ever met him, and we've known each other for nearly, I think it's about 7-8 years. Talked regularly on the phone about photography and all sorts of stuff, and to actually see the body of work that he's got as well. He's got a lot of things that he's been sitting on, didn't think were good enough, and I've been going, whoa, just get it out there, it's fantastic.
So. Tristan Campbell's, if you Google Tristan Campbell Photography, I think his website comes up, and it's worth looking at. There's some great photography in there.
Yeah.
I bought his 10-8 off him.
Did
and
you?
He shoots 5.4, 5.7, and a lot of medium format film.
Again,
mostly neg, isn't it?
He was responsible for this sort of 4-day exercise, trying to understand what was going
on. So you've been trying out colour neg?
Yeah, well, he's been getting me to shoot large format cameras, which I find very difficult.
Upside down is a bit
alien. Like this all the time. Yeah. I'm trying to see what on earth's going
just
on.
Just turn the camera over. It helps.
Yeah.
But it's been pretty difficult. But yeah. I've seen a body of things that I like more than an individual image.
Excellent. Okay, Stephen's got another couple. We'll go with number two, which is, what are your photography goals for 2015?
That's a really good question, actually. Well, I've got a lot going on my plate. As soon as I reach more towards April, I've got a lot of trips away, a lot of running around. But I've been really thinking about what I've been doing in a local capacity, because I think this is something that happens to a lot of photographers, is that you end up, you get successful perhaps and run a business, and then the business overtakes perhaps what you would normally do. And I found that personally, I don't do enough of what I began doing, which was having a small idea and going out with my other half and going walking and having some fun and taking photographs and trying to use those photographs to perpetuate interest in my local environment. And everything I do, which is Dartmoor related or coastal related and things like that, has now sort of dried up, because the last thing I actually want to do is go out and take photographs of a weekend. I've got things like, I've got to go to Asda, and then on Saturday I've got to do loads of other stuff as well on top of things. So I've had a normal, a lot of the time, working week, or an abnormal working week. So everything's all over the place, and I want to start to get back into doing stuff where I am. I started on the other day, where I went out to a really obscure section of Dartmoor Woodland and found absolutely nothing exciting except two trees, which were pretty unusual, to say the least. But it was this whole thing of just getting out and walking again and doing stuff, having a reason to go out. So my objective over the next few months, especially as I've got some time in between trips, is to go out with Rachel a lot more and for us to explore and do things and revisit as well, things I haven't seen ages. But this time, take the cameras and go and do that.
Yeah, because we haven't seen much of your Dartmoor stuff, apart from the Wisman's Wood stuff.
Yeah, exactly.
Which was really nice to see.
Yeah, I haven't done a lot of local photography for quite some time, but that's just part of the course, you know. That's what happens when things take off and you end up running around all over the place. But I wish to return back and look at stuff again. And I've visited a few locations that I visited right at the very, very start when I began photography, maybe 10 years ago. And it was quite interesting to go back there and see them with completely fresh eyes and realise that what I was chasing around after at the time was actually not very relevant at all. And yet I was so locked down into it at the time.
You know? Yeah, the location doesn't change, but you do.
Yeah, exactly. Your vision changes very much. So.
What about yourself, David?
I don't ever really think that I have particular goals. I sort of meander along, really. I'd like to do some more writing this year. I'd like to come up with an idea for a new book project. I've got some thoughts about that, because Landscape Beyond was 6 years ago now, 7 years ago.
Somebody's asking later on about new books.
So I'd like to do that. But I sort of feel that I can't really force that. It has to occur to me. I'd like to, you know, it seems ironic with David here talking about going to film. I'd like to explore digital a bit more. So this is a bit like at the conference when Paul Gallagher started doing colour and I said, right, I'll do black and white. I mean, actually, black and white, I've been shooting a lot of black and white recently, digitally.
On film, on digital?
Yeah, and I'm enjoying that, because that's where I started in photography.
What digital are you using at the moment?
I'm just using the Fuji XE1 at the minute. And I'm not sure where to go with all of that, really, because I know it's not, you know, it's a very nice camera, but it's obviously not as capable as a full-frame DSLR. Yeah. I'm feeling my way through that, but all of these things, I don't really set out with a particular plan. I see where things take me, really.
We have a geological question next for the both of you.
Okay. I'm a geology graduate.
To be more specific, volcanology. Somebody's asked, is the lava flow in Iceland going to stop before I get there in June?
Could do. Allegedly.
Maybe.
I think it's definitely possible.
Possible.
Yeah.
Well, that's number three done.
It was very impressive from the things I saw happening.
It's a long way off in the middle of the ice cap, isn't it?
It was really explosive at the start. The pressure.
It's just a bubbly crack in the land.
It just came down and apparently it was just a lot of, you know,
it surges now and again and overflows, I believe. That's
running
it.
Running around.
Yeah.
Catlaw is the one that he would really like to see.
I think there's more chance that Catlaw will go off than that'll stop. I think that's there for quite a while now.
Yeah.
Because it's just flowing. It's a huge, huge hole in the ground.
Yeah.
And there's a big pluson underneath it just feeding it more and more lava. But, Catlaw's overdue by How many years?
25 years or 30 years or something. Yeah.
So the big one. Imagine a Fiatliokl about 10 times the size. I don't know in volume.
It's several kilometres across the crater, isn't it? It's huge. Yeah. And it's hidden under the ice. And last time it erupted, it added 4 kilometres to the southern coastline of Iceland. So that gives you some idea of how much material came out of it.
The only downside of that is the explosion will close air traffic across the whole of Europe. So you'll have to take a train over to Siberia and then fly from there around the other way.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah, you won't be able to get across to the Atlantic, potentially. I don't know.
This is another illness story. But I was in Portugal when that went off. I was in Lisbon, and we were on the last couple of days of a 2-week trip, and we were stuck in Lisbon for another week and a half.
Oh, no.
And then Rach got food poisoning. Can you believe it?
You've got poor weak constitution.
I don't know what's going on when I travel a place like that, but we were stuck there for another week and a half.
Yeah, we weren't going out there. It was just
we were trying to get home, and they were just saying to us that we couldn't get back. So I stayed for 3.5 weeks in Lisbon. Yeah. I know it intimately.
If you are interested in going to the volcano, we did look at Vathra in Iceland, of how you can get to it, and pretty much now it's closed to all road traffic, most foot traffic, unless you're really, really committed, and it costs about £1,000 each to go and flight over it.
Right.
From Akureyri.
Right.
A bit rich, really, for a couple of hours over a volcano. Once in a lifetime experience, but I could live without it. Next question. David's talk was inspiration. Now, which one?
Not here, it's mine.
Well, he's the surprise guest, so he wasn't supposed to be here, was he?
I'm on commission here.
I'd love to get some details on the next conference. I'll get to the way together, please. I'm new to digital photography and photography in general. I've been watching Joe Cornish's DVD, and I'm amazed at the amount of different camera equipment available. Some more information on pointers would be great, please. Well, the first one about the conference. We'll be running a short one-day conference this year, and we're going to do the full weekend conference in 2016. Partly because we don't want to commit ourselves to a large conference, and trying to book people who've got workshops already settled is almost impossible. Everybody's got all their workshops laid out for the whole year. So when we looked at it in January, everybody was saying, no, can't do that, can't do this, can't do the other. So we are
It was difficult for you anyway, because you can't start planning another conference on top of one that hasn't run.
Yes.
And then know whether the first one was a success before you started booking people the following year.
Exactly.
So it's going to work that way, and then hopefully you'll get your...
So every 2 years.
Then you get a rolling process going.
But we'll probably do one day ones around the country. So we do one south, one middle, and one in the north somewhere. In terms of the amount of different camera equipment available, some information and pointers. A bit of a general question. This was from Tim Ray.
Well, it's bewildering, isn't it?
I mean,
and new models coming out all the time. I don't know, when you have workshop participants, how out of touch do you feel when they bring a camera that you've never seen before?
It's not, it doesn't happen so much, I guess. But I mean, the majority of the time, there's a lot of the usual Canon, Nikon stuff, so it's all going to be fairly similar. And the format of a lot of it hasn't changed over the last maybe 3-4 years. Nothing's really change that much with regard to menus and wherever.
No, just controls are in different places, aren't they? But
features and things like that.
Are people still mostly DSLRs?
I think there's a mix. I think that there's probably, I would say, 80 on a trip like that. Yeah, 80-90% of people are going to be DSLRs. But there are people who bring things like the Fuji systems and various other bits. But the majority do take DSLRs because it's down to the biggest issue of all, which is durability, especially with a lot of the places that we go to the winter months. But overall, no, it's a nice mix, and it's always nice to see that a lot of participants that you get will be running all manner of different systems.
So one individual may have three cameras.
But also, you might just have something really entry level. And they were a bit worried sometimes that you come in with something really entry level and that it's not going to be an acceptable thing, and that what you're doing might push the limits of what they can capture. But, 99% of the time, it's never anything. And even Arctic temperatures, you'd be surprised about consumer DSLRs that work perfectly well.
So for Tim's question, Tim is called
Tim Ray.
Yeah,
not David.
No. So is there a model that you would recommend as somebody who's starting out is just going to pick up a DSLR?
Well, I mean, there's a whole myriad, isn't there? If I chip in with the ones I know the most about, which is probably all of the Canon systems, I still believe now that the 6D represents probably the biggest full frame bargain that you can that you can ever have, because of the fact being that the features that it gives you, the sensor technology is so excellent, and generally overall it's a very, very easy to use camera.
You've said to me, I think it's got a lot of advantages still over the 5D3.
It does.
And what do you lose? What do you lose against
5D3? Well, you've got a stop of extra quality with regard to high ISO.
Yeah.
You obviously have a real compromise with regard to AF, but which is a little...
For landscape, yeah. Worry about. Doesn't move as much.
I don't worry about that at all.
Yeah.
But there are many, many features of the 5D3 that give it its niche, and there's many features of the 6D that perhaps are lacking in one and are stronger in the other. But for me, it's always been GPS, and I've always found that extremely useful wherever I go. So I'm building up a library of like places I've been to, and I can look at all these. 6 months' time, I come to capturing keyword images, and bang, everything's there. And again, it's not what everybody does, but devoid of that, it's the overall quality of the sensor and quality of the camera. And it's just ridiculously good when it comes to static subjects and focusing on even slight movement, and the centre spot is rated at -3 LV, as it's called, which gives you extremely good autofocus in the centre, not so much on the edges, but even with the old, what looks like 5D2 diamond shape AF, it's very good in the middle, even in really, really low light. So, but there's lots of other bodies and lenses. There's obviously the crop sensor ones, like the 70D series and things like that are always progressing and advancing with technology. There's also a lot of the smaller consumer cameras, even down to things like 100D systems and all those, which are also very popular.
Well, they're capable. I mean, I'm just looking at a photograph behind by Nigel Norton. One of the Misty Woods there was taken on a 350D, which
there
is
an
old, about 8 megapixel or 10 megapixel camera.
And I've still got my original 5D, although it's converted to infrared. One of the reasons why I upgraded it was because of the fact being that I wanted to create larger file sizes, which were better for image sales. But I even think now that, okay, it's probably a bit long in the tooth now, but I would have said up until a few years ago, I would still have been happy probably shooting and blending my way around problems with dynamic range and things like that, because it's what I'd always been doing from...
So would you be better off spending your money on a good lens and getting a second-hand digital or something like that, or a cheaper digital?
Yeah, I still think that's a better idea. I mean, when you consider that something like the 60 is, £1,200, and you consider that what you get for that £1,200, it's still probably one of the biggest bargains out there. It's been an extremely good seller for Canon. But, I mean, there's many Nikon equivalents, there's many other systems.
Yeah, I think the mirrorless cameras are really good as well. I mean, they've really come on tremendously.
So have you been using the Sony stuff or anything like that?
I haven't had a chance to use the Sony, but I've been using the Fuji XE system. And that's, if you get the higher range lenses, the XF lenses, they're fantastic, really good lenses. And the lenses make a big difference. Yeah, I mean, that's got a great sensor. It's, again, like you said, it's not brilliant on autofocus for fast moving subjects, but you don't need to worry about that for landscape.
That seeds into the next question, which is, somebody said, do you have any thoughts about the new upcoming 50 megapixel Canon?
I've got loads of thoughts about it. I think it's going to be an absolute revelation system. I mean, again, I think you've got to be wanting to create images and print images that are going to be, they're going to require that type of megapixel.
Yeah.
And, it's not going to be a constant progression of up and up and up. It's like there's an available market, and that available market is going to be satisfied by Canon because they know that there is the market there.
Yeah.
I don't think it's ever going to be a situation where that camera is then going to, it's every single model that comes up is now going to be 50 minimum. It can't be.
Yeah.
There's no point in doing that. But what it does represent is a very good area for them to move into. There's been a lot of rivalry from Nikon and D800 and D810s and things like that, so it'll be really interesting. Plus, the last 2 years have been them working to produce lenses that can operate with this camera. And although there's, you might well know of the landmark wide angle that came out, 16-35 f4.
You were showing me some pictures of that earlier on, which is extraordinary.
It is remarkable. And also the 24-70 2.8 Mark II.
Which I run on my Sony because it's such a good lens.
And all these other lenses are all now capable of resolving a 50 megapixel sensor. I've yet to get my hands on one at the moment, so I'm only speaking from speculation and things that I've read. But it's a really big buzz going around at the moment with regard to it all. And I think that overall, it's going to be a game of compromises. You're never going to have technology where you've got a 50 megapixel sensor on a 35 mil system and expect for that to be able to run at 102,500 ISO with seamless.
That was the interesting thing, is because they've said the maximum ISO is 6400 on it.
Right.
I was happy with 200.
Yeah. nice for 400 or 200. Yeah. But the reason for that, they said, is that a lot of cameras like the D800 or the 5D2 have had the colour filters have been very transparent. And they've said this time they put very, very intense colour filters in front of it to try and get more accurate colour.
Right.
And the trade-off to get more accurate colour is to lose light performance because, you know, a red filter that you might put on a black and white camera.
Losing a couple of stops.
Yeah. And that's the equivalent of going from 6400 to 250-600. So I'm interested to see what the colour quality will be like on it. Because I think...
Well, I think that's the next thing that really still has to be addressed in a way, isn't it? I mean, you were talking about the quality of film. You're not talking about resolution. You're talking about how it feels, aren't you?
Absolutely.
Yeah, and...
The render.
Yeah, the render. And film has still got more subtlety than digital has at the moment and is better at differentiating colours than digital is.
Yeah.
Except at the very high end, maybe at a phase or something like that.
We looked at the IQ. There's a couple of cameras. There's the IQ 280 and the 260s are good.
Yeah.
And that old Sony A900, which I've had for a long time.
Yeah.
Very accurate colour. But that couldn't do anything above ISO 100 or 200.
Right.
It was that thick colour filters on it, I think.
Yeah, and I think that's the next thing for them to work out, I think. I think, is there much point beyond 50 megapixels? I don't think there is, really. I mean, you can already get a really large print out of that, very high quality.
I'll give you an example. I was around Tristan's house the other day and he had a lovely image that he'd shot of a wall just disappearing off with this tree in the background and sort of pink sunrise going on. A very subtle sunrise happening and it was all the walls all caked in frost. And I said, that's, you know, remarkable. I said, when did you take that? He said, I did that about 2006. And I said, what did you shoot it on? And he said, it was a 5D Mark I. And it was like an A2 print. And I walked up to it and looked around it. I can't see anything. Not want me to shoot.
What was the 5D Mark I? Was that 12 megapixels?
Yeah,
12. Yeah.
So that means
He would have had to be upsized twice, probably, and he still managed to do it.
But I mean, a 48 megapixel sensor is only twice the resolution linearly, because you've got 12 megapixels to go double. You got to get four times as much megapixels. So it's not really a huge increase from 36. Nikon to 50 Canon is only about an extra 20% linear resolution, so it's only 20% bigger print.
I think to do that and have control of noise and control of many other aspects is the hard part.
Yeah. Those are the things that still need to be dealt with. Although you have to say, I mean, the noise is much, much better in digital than it was in film for equivalent ISOs. So,
there is something about print sizes where you reach a certain resolution and you don't need more detail.
No.
Because you blow up bigger and you step away up to a point people don't nose prints once they get to about 30 inch by 40 inch.
Yeah, once you get beyond a certain size, you're not likely to do the print sniffing thing, are you? Because you want to apprehend the whole picture, you have to step back to do it. So yeah, it becomes a pointless exercise in a way. The thing that you should get is more subtlety of colour.
Yes.
With the more pixels you've got, you should be able to
now you can do what's like pixel binning almost.
Yeah.
Say each Bayer cluster of three colours can make a single pixel.
Yeah, and that should make a big difference. So it's not about, I don't think it's been about resolution for quite a long time, really. It's about those other qualitative changes, and I think that's all exciting stuff, I think.
Yeah, it's an exciting time, I think, for photographers overall, and it'd be really interesting to see, you know, a change in the lead and see what happens and how people feel about all this as well, because I think a lot of people have been thinking about one thing and the other with regard to, you know, when's the answer going to come from Canon and all the rest of it, and now it's here. I think that, you know, it'll be really interesting to see how this evolves. Yeah. But also, now with such a large megapixel camera, what people actually think of that and where they then go with their own photography and whether they're going to be concerned, because it's going to lock down technique.
Yes.
You're going to have to be really, really strict about everything you do.
You know, lots of people say that about the Nikon, and it's going to be
tripod as solid as possible, standing on rock. You know,
and I think tilt lenses are going to have to be, more people will use tilt lenses as well.
Yeah.
So somebody's asked a sort of related question. Wonder what causes Canon and Nikon and Sony to actually release a 12 megapixel model when they're also releasing 36 megapixel models?
Because it's not about anything other than diversity. That's the reason why, for all of it. It's all diversity.
Now, I mean, you take photographs for magazines or... for a magazine, 12 megapixels is probably enough, is it, for a front cover?
Easily. You could do it 7, I think. Yeah. You know, it wouldn't be too bad.
So they're probably thinking about you, sort of photojournalists. Want just the right size for what
I think the Sony... I don't... Again, I'm not speaking from experience with this, because I haven't got one, but I've spoken to my good friend Simon Butterworth, who bought an A7R, is it?
Or
the,
yes, the S? The S.
12 megapixel S. And he wanted it primarily because he does... street photography a lot more than he ever used to, and he'd seen all these options and opportunities that were unfolding in him where he could take photographs of people who were in dimly lit street lights or things like this, and every time he'd try and go and do it, he'd be banging the noise right up and everything. So he thought that would be a good camera to be able to do that style of work. So I think with all of these systems, I think it was because the bottlenecks are so wide that and no one's thinking about you know, the size of a shot so much anymore. You can do anything with 12, you can do anything with 21, and you know, you can take massive steps with 50, but at the same time it's about the style of shot that you want, the thing that you're doing, and what counts and what you actually want to pursue. And I think that 12 with incredible ISO performance is exciting, just like 21 with good performances also, and 50 accordingly. So it's
picking. They're actually giving different cameras in the range for different types of photographers and different types of uses, which is good. Never be a bad thing.
You consider what I've been thinking about this week. And also, you know, you've got this crazy Robbie the Robot style drum scanner, the biggest thing I've ever
seen. The Tango.
Yes. Is it called a Heisenberg or something?
Heisenberg. It's an uncertain scanner.
It's where he keeps his dead cat.
Producing scans of that that were like 18,000 by 10,000 or something.
Yeah.
Like, you need to make an 18,000 by 10,000 scan, and the answer is yes.
Yes.
But why?
I've only had one opportunity ever to do that, which was
just crazy though.
Somebody wanted a 13 meter by 2 meter print.
There we go. If you have the availability to do that, then that's
13 meters.
Yeah. Sadly, it fell through, but it would have been. I stitched two 10.8s together for it.
Right.
Eight gigabyte file in the end. But.
I reckon you'd probably just hit those opportunities. Guinness Book of World Records.
Yeah, those opportunities show up once every 5 years or something. But most of the time, I don't know, what's the biggest prints you've sold or biggest usage, you reckon?
Oh, that's really difficult to say. I mean, one of the things I did at a Canon CPS trade show was I stitched, I think it was 15 1DS3 files together, the whole Manhattan skyline from downtown Manhattan all the way up to the Empire State Building. Yeah. And we printed that out as something like, I think it was about 12 or 15 foot by 48 inches.
Yeah.
And someone stood on it.
Oh, no.
I can believe it. So I had to print another one, of course.
Yeah.
I just walked backwards over it. It was on the floor, sort of thing. Please do not go anywhere near this print. And this guy walked up to a coffee machine, was chatting to his mate, and walked back on it and stood on it. So anyway, we printed another one like you do. And it was absolutely gobsmacking to see.
I can imagine.
And when you can stand there and you realise that... you can almost see the TV remote on someone's sofa inside a building in the tower block in the Chrysler Building. No, it was not that much, but you know, you can see that level of detail of what's going on. It's a real wonder to behold, and that's the reason why these things get made.
It's immersive. I think that's a good word for it, isn't it? You fall into the picture.
Image library say to me, like, well, if you can sort of downsize these pictures, we don't really need them that big. And I thought, but you could tell them as like really large images for installation art or something. It's like, no, we don't need them that big. If you could make them about, I don't know, about 4,000 wide or something. I was like absolutely gutted. There's my 25,000 by 4,000, 5,000 high print, whatever. And they said, because we're only likely able to sell it as web banners.
Yeah.
It's a shame. And then we go around the circle again, don't we, of megapixels and size and what we need and what's viable. And
It's usage, though, isn't it?
You've done some very big prints, haven't you, for sure?
5 foot by 4 foot prints, yeah. But you know, on 5 foot, it's only 12 times magnification, isn't it? So it's not that big, really, is it?
I think that sort of shot, that sort of print, is what a lot of people are thinking about. I might do one day. I might have an exhibition, and when I do, I want to be able to have some huge prints on the wall.
I think they have their place, and I mean, I sold a fair number of them. And they are amazing objects, but actually, no, you're not going to make those size prints very often. Yeah. And I don't use a 5.4 in order to be able to make those size prints. No. I use a 5.4 because of the process, because of the way I have to work with it. Yeah.
And you can see upside down and back to front.
Yeah.
Somehow.
Yeah.
Like, yeah. Come on.
Well, it's rotated through 180 degrees, is what it is.
I'm like this all the time.
Yeah. Yeah. You'll stop after a while. It's okay.
On to the next question, because we're wondering again. Have a time check. Do you know what time we're on? David? 8:55. Okay, so we're doing well, I think. We have a question from Bert Vliegen. For both Tim and David, or David and David and David, are there any signs that Fujifilm will sell Velvia 50 in Europe or not?
Not as far as I can tell. And I think that's the problem, is that it's not actually Fujifilm in the UK, is it?
No, it's a subsidiary.
It's a subsidiary. So it's a franchise,
actually,
in fact.
It wasn't even a subsidiary, was it?
It's a franchise.
A company, yeah.
Yeah, so the only places you can buy Fujifilm, the only places you can buy Velvia are places where they sell direct, as far as I can tell.
I believe one of the problems was exchange rate and tax problems in Japan, from what I've heard.
Right.
That made exporting just not viable.
Right. It's interesting. I mean, they obviously feel they've got a big enough market to carry on making and manufacturing it just in Japan.
Because they reboxed it all and redesigned all the boxes for it as well, which is interesting.
But I can't see them selling it again, no. Not unless somebody else took over the franchise.
And to be fair, you can buy it from Japan at reasonable prices anyway. There are quite a few people on eBay and I think a couple of companies who will order it.
Yeah, well, reasonable is a relative thing compared to what it used to cost. But
yeah, it's gone up to about £4 a sheet, I think.
It used to cost less than £2, didn't it?
Big changes.
Yeah.
But I don't think it's going to disappear for a while now.
It already has disappeared. It's all in your fridge.
I have most of the supply.
And I have the other half.
You've got the other half. It's outrageous. I've seen nothing like this ever.
You've got to keep the house moved down.
People running around with pitchforks trying to find who got the last Velvia quick load.
I'm going
to
bleed it all onto the market over the next 5 years.
Oh, well, I haven't got any quick load. No. Anna's got all the quick load, I think.
Right, next question from Aman Agrawe. Is pre-visualization still relevant in the modern age of digital photography? Spray and pray, I presume he's sort of referring to. If so, how and to what extent can an image be pre-visualized? Also, when you are out photographing, do you have a pre-thought-out narrative that you would like to convey with a certain kind of image and a certain kind of light, or do you just roll with the punches?
Well, pre-visualization, I think there's a lot of post-justification a lot of the time with Ansel and various other people, like Edward Weston, what they were really referring to was understanding how they were going to render those tones in a black and white print. And so they needed to understand the process all the way through, but I'm not sure that they actually pre-visualized the composition or the image.
Before they arrived.
Yeah. No, I don't think they did at all. I think there are sort of two ways that people make pictures. And you could say that the way that a large format photographer makes a picture is in a way always going to be a form of visualization, because you have to really study it and you have to really think about what you're going to do before you press the button. You have to really work out what your framing is going to be, because you are not going to make multiple exposures to work around a subject. Whereas most people working with a DSLR or a mirrorless camera will sketch their way towards a composition. They'll make a number of images and they'll refine on each iteration and they'll get to a final composition. Either way is entirely fine. It depends on how you work. I think pre-visualization has been put up as a sort of gold standard about how we are supposed to do it.
Yeah, well, Ansel sort of denied that when he reprocessed all his images completely differently.
Yeah.
So they weren't pre-visualized, obviously.
No. Well, he added the pre, didn't he? Wasn't it Weston who called it visualization and Ansel called it pre-visualization?
Yeah.
I can't remember, because the pre is redundant, really.
Yes.
Is it still relevant? It is relevant to have some notion of what you're probably trying to work with and through and towards. It's much better than spray and pray. That's
learn
for sure.
How your camera sees. I think that's a good way of putting it, maybe.
Yeah, yeah. But I think anybody who handles a camera for a long time starts to get a feel for that. Mm. But I don't think that you have to have a narrative worked out beforehand. I mean, most of my images are actually made in reaction to what I find, in a sense of wonder of what I found. And so there's no way that I could actually...
script it before we went.
No, because I wouldn't have the wonder beforehand, yeah. No.
Do you think a lot of the narrative that people read about in pictures is actually the photographer trying to interpret their own pictures because they've done it instinctively and then they've gone, well, what was I thinking at the time?
But in fact, the post-justification or the narrative that's put on afterwards could well actually be whatever the motive was bubbling to the surface. I mean, a lot of the time we are moved by our subconscious to find something interesting, attractive, something yeah. that we want to make a photograph of. And we might not, at the time when we make the image, have fully realised what's going on. You know, the conscious part of our mind and the subconscious part of our mind, obviously they don't talk to each other all the time, do yeah. they? So, so I think it's just always good to work with care and to immerse yourself in trying to make a photograph. I don't think the visualisation, whatever that is necessarily the key to that.
Do you know what your pictures are going to look like when you press the shutter?
What do? I go somewhere. I've got a fairly good idea of what's happening, and by the time I get there, the weather's picked up, the wind's whipping around, I've nearly dropped my lens on the sand or something silly like that, or I have, or yeah. you know, and then the weather's gone completely over the sun, or the sun's gone completely into the horrible band of cloud I always get down in South Devon, or things like that. You know, there's all this sort of stuff, and yeah, you can come back and you can post-rationalise it into this remarkable story that I think, gladly, also sadly, I would say, has gone with regard to people's pieces about their own photographs. There needs to be a sort of like a formula or a template in there, and
yeah.
you'd always like be reluctant to go there because the weather was bad,
and then all of a sudden
the sky opened and God rays came everywhere and you were blessed with heavenly light and
yeah.
all this sort of stuff. But I mean, you know, during the time, there's nothing like that. It's like, why I gave up using filter holders and things like that, because every time I did, I'd like be fiddling around with them and they'd be falling off and more than I'd be doing any work. So I just changed my
dexterous
way.
Are you dexterous? Yeah. You were a musician, weren't you?
I do my research, I've got an idea as to why I'm going to go there, but then when I get there, usually I sort of go, oh, look at this is marvellous, and
yeah,
and many other people know me because I'm just turned into a miserable bugger who moans all the time. And I just, because I keep up in my bar all the time, I'm trying to sort of make the better picture as I can.
So constantly feel dissatisfied.
Yeah, I always do. Yeah, I'm always like feeling pretty okay. And if I get something that works, I'm sort of okay about it. And I'm still like looking back over my shoulder as I'm walking back, just thinking like next time I know what to do, next time I know where I'm going to go. And it's that fire that you get inside you that becomes, it's the excitement of doing it. But I've little to say about the subject when it comes to afterwards, or you know, I don't,
it's a photograph, why need to explain
romance,
it.
It's just get on with it, yeah. You know.
Roger Voller asks, perhaps when going to a new place, do you have preconceived perception of what will be taken or spontaneous free will? This is very similar to the last one, but do you purposely avoid cliché shots that have been done before? Or do you take a shot for yourself regardless, thinking it will come out different anyway?
I do tend to ignore them because they're not my voice. So I try and make something that speaks to me.
But if you're in an iconic location, you won't try and avoid the iconic location, you'll just try and interpret it.
Yeah, I might be there for a tour, but I probably wouldn't make the picture of the buckle or the picture of I don't know, maroon bells. I probably wouldn't do that.
Yeah.
I think that's because what I'm trying to do with my photography is not about those kind of vistas. I'm trying to explore colour and vision and the difference between how I see and how the camera sees, and so that vista is not for me saying what I want to say. So I would probably try and ignore it.
Just sneak one in. Keep it yourself. You can look it on your iPhone and smile.
Yeah, never show it to anybody else. Yeah, Guilty secret. Yeah, I've got a huge collection of those on the iPhone. Yeah, but I mean, that's not. I'm not trying to be elitist about that. It's just what
you
I want to do.
Didn't you? At one stage.
Yeah, probably at the beginning I did. Yeah, because
what you did, and you didn't feel there's much more else to learn from it, so you went looking for other stuff, perhaps. Or
the first few years, I did a lot of vista photography. I did a lot of commission stuff, which involved shooting vistas, because that's what the book publishers wanted, or the magazine publishers wanted, or whatever. So, yeah, I did shoot a lot of that kind of stuff. But I don't, I think I took photographs for 20 years before I actually started making the kind of photographs that I wanted to make. And I think once I started making the photographs that I wanted to make, I wasn't so interested in doing the other things. Now, I can absolutely see why those cliched subjects are the cliched subjects, because they are amazing. They're fascinating. They're fabulous places. And you can see why they interest people.
Yeah, totally.
But I don't think that for me, I could make an image of those places that would say something that came from my heart, that was about what I felt or was trying to express about those places.
That's fair enough. I mean, you're looking at it from a personal vision to a commercial vision to all these different other zones.
Yeah.
As to why people would photograph something.
Yeah.
Who does it for people who do it for a living, I guess, is what we're saying in that sense as well. But that would change your reasons as to why to do it. I know it's changed my reasons as to why to do things. I mean, I've got a tour coming up with Iceland, and that's coming up at Christmas next year. But this one I just did.
Yeah.
I felt quite dissatisfied with being there again. And then when I actually got there, I just snapped out of it and felt right about it.
Yeah.
But there was obviously, if you're going to return to the same locations again and again and again, and you've taken pictures that you're fairly happy with, you're going to find it pretty hard to if it's not so inspiring weather-wise or anything at the time, to get the camera out. But no one, I don't think anyone would turn their back on, amazing golden light and shimmering, glistening icebergs and things, for example.
But you can look at it, you don't have to photograph it.
Yeah, do you find it difficult that, I mean, we went to an ice cave last year.
Yeah.
And
it was the most amazing ice cave.
Yeah. But when we came back, there was on Flickr and various other websites hundreds of photographs of exactly the same ice cave, many of them exactly the same shots, nearly, with slightly different conditions. And I found that quite, I don't know, it's weird thinking. I didn't feel like my shots. I got one shot that didn't look like anybody else's, but I did a couple of shots and thinking, why is mine special? I've gone to the same locations as everybody else, taking the same shots. And do you get that feeling when you're out there?
Yeah, I do.
Just,
you can't help it. I mean, but that's, you're there for a reason, and you're inspiring other people and helping guide them to take photographs.
But that's you as a tour workshop leader.
Oh, do you mean me as a...
You as a photographer, do you find yourself wanting to take pictures but trying to get something that somebody else isn't going to take in that location?
I just imagine the fact that I could be somewhere out in Vatnajökull Glacier photographing through a hole in the ice with Aurora or something. In other words, my mind gets taken into second, third, fourth gear. And it's when you're doing things and you're obviously having to run a trip, that's going to lead to a specific style of work that you have to do, or a specific style of adventure. But my mind does race about the ideas of what I could possibly achieve if I was in a different situation.
More freedom.
But once you've done things like that, you've done them a few times, you're never not active. You quite enjoy being in there, because the more you start pointing your camera around, the more you start thinking, oh, there's weird bands of weird light going through them, and one's dark and one's light and all sort of other stuff.
Yeah.
You start seeing things in...
Well, they're amazing places to be, always, yeah.
Yeah.
I've got a slightly philosophical point to make about this, I suppose, in that if you think about photography, what we do is we quote from reality with the camera. I mean, that's what's different between photography and other visual arts. The other visual arts are constructed. And I know, there's a huge amount of montaging and all that kind of stuff that goes on now, but basically what a photograph is a quote from reality. And if you make the same quote as somebody else, then you haven't actually said anything. Oh. You haven't said anything that's yours. You're just copying. Now I can understand in a technical sense that you want to practice to see how that picture was made, or you want to go to that place and you want to experience it, and maybe you want to take my guilty collection of all those shots on my iPhone. and that's completely valid, and it's a fine thing to do. But philosophically, if you think about it, those photographs are all the same. There's no real difference between them, I don't think. So,
and then it comes back to the conundrum of that a lot of people have got busy lives and children and weekends, and and then they've only got, you know, they've got that 1 week where they've saved up their money and they've gone on holiday and they want to go and they don't mind, they just want to go and see it, and that's
entirely valid as well.
It
all depends what you want the photograph for.
Exactly.
Do you want it as a commission? Do you want it as something that is your statement, or do you want it as a memento? Which, you know, given that 47.3% of all statistics are made up, 99.9% of photographs in the world are taken as mementos. That's what most people make photographs for.
Someone said to me early in my career, after I started going to a handful of places, that, you know, whichever way you look at it, David, even if you don't make a living out of it, at least you'll have a collection of the most bloody amazing holiday snacks.
That's one hell of a slideshow.
One hell of a holiday snack show.
Yeah.
I personally enjoy a location more when I've got a camera with me, because it makes me look at things.
Yeah.
And regardless of the photographs, having the camera gets me in locations I would never have gone to.
Yeah.
Which is great.
I think the greatest gift that photography has given me has been to make me really look at the world around me. Whether I've in my life as a photographer ever make anything that's really amazing or not, that has still enriched my life enormously, and that's a great gift to give ourselves, isn't it? I think
you've also, I think, led the way with your abstracts in a massive sense. And I was discussing this with you earlier on today. We were talking about, you know, that I have the privilege of sitting back and enjoying what you create, because of the fact being that I can do it without any kind of landscape orientated judgment in that sense. I'm talking about more of your abstract style than your landscape. Which of course I judge constantly.
you were saying that if you look at somebody else's vista, that you think, oh well, I would have stood slightly to the right or whatever, or the left, but that what I shoot with the abstracts is so different from what you do that you just absorb it.
I look at it and I can't, for the first 3 to 4 seconds, I can't work out what I'm actually looking at. And that's a wonderful frenzy of, like, I'm just going around the picture trying to attach onto something that makes me go, oh, it's a shot of shadows going through a broken old wall onto something in the, I don't know, I can't think of examples, but it's that fun that I can sort of throw myself into that and enjoy it for exactly what it is, which is you know, which you've led the way with in respects to that style. And lots of people enjoy, you know, it's like you're coming down from the horizon a lot of the time. If you're the coast, you ain't, you know, there's no horizon and clouds, we don't want that bit, we want,
oh god, why would you photograph the sky?
Well, the gold bit underneath, and that's what counts.
Yeah.
We have a couple of quick joined questions. I'll join these two together.
Conjoined questions.
It's a combination of Yola DeLoosenet and Roger Cohen's. Now, Yola has asked, can you mention something about photographing on dark, dreary and drizzly days? And Roger Cohen has asked, I'm going to Ireland in the next few days, and where can I photograph? Ireland. Iceland.
Iceland.
Yeah.
Well, I was going to say Ireland then. Helps
him out
with that.
Where and what can I photograph when the weather is bad in Iceland?
All of it,
yeah. All of it. Yeah, because it's going to be bad the whole time anyway, I think.
Yeah.
What to do on dark and drizzly days? Well, the landscape at a smaller scale works pretty much no matter what the weather's like. So get into some woodland, do something that's you know, a bit like the Mark Littlejohn picture that I was talking about earlier, where it was misty and murky and had a huge amount of mood as a result.
Rain can look like mist when it's
quite
heavy.
Yeah. Or shoot details. Yeah. Something more abstract, or maybe not abstract, maybe figurative, but a detail. Because actually, when it's wet, the colours can be absolutely amazing in those conditions. They can be really, really strong and vibrant. So it's certainly not, you know, not bad conditions. There's an American photographer who said the only bad light is no light, and that's right. You can shoot in any kind of conditions, really.
There's no poor conditions, only poor decisions.
Is that right? Okay, that's a variation.
Yes.
Yeah.
What I made up.
Is it?
<Just
then. laughs> so yeah, I would always look at a more intimate scale if the weather is like that. You're not going to get a big vista if it's dark and drizzly. You won't see very far.
And if it's drizzly in Iceland, it cleans off all the icebergs, gets rid of all the black sand.
I think with all of it, I mean, it depends on when we're talking about flat, featureless grey sky. And then worrying about the fact that we can't take vistas, and then doing what I do is walk around moaning a lot and getting miserable. But the fact is that it's all about diversity and trying to change your vision, and if you can change your vision related to the images. I always remember I learned something last year, which was, it doesn't really relate to landscape, it relates to doing other stuff. I started playing around with this thing called vortigraphs, where you are taking photographs and spinning other parts of photographs into them and doing all sorts of manner of odd things. And I found that the light to do it was on incredibly dull days. So I did one in particular that was related to a very small area around by the Houses of Parliament. So I went on the opposite side of the Thames and shot the House of Parliament from one side. I did the London Eye, I did Big Ben, I did all these quadrigas, these horses that were sitting on top of the newsagents, and various other bits. And then got back and montaged them all in together and did something almost graphic design like. And it worked so well in flat light, and it made me suddenly go, oh, I just need to do more of this. Because it's other things that you can do. Mm. And you might find that you have a style of things that you can do in a specific light, therefore go and do that when it happens. Or we were...
Flat light's what I use most of the time.
Yeah.
Remember the picture of the boat behind you is flat light.
Right,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Very grey.
It's like a big softbox.
Yeah. Yeah.
Managing camera gear in the cold and wet... How do you deal with it? Especially when you've been out in minus 38 or minus 30. Are there any particular things you need to do to make sure your camera gear doesn't lock up?
Well, I mean, I recommend using Morrison's bags. They're really good.
Yeah,
don't bother with these expensive rain covers. Just put a Morrison's bag over.
Yeah.
You can make a little hole on the back and take off the viewfinder. And then push it against that. Put the viewfinder back on. Bingo! You just stick your hands up underneath.
Excellent.
The reason I choose Morrison's over Tesco's or Asda's because they're clear. Well, they used to be.
Okay.
So that's one thing I do if it's raining. But then I don't really shoot much in the rain. I have to say, it's sort of, you know, things get a bit wet, and I've got an old towel that I've got on the top of my bag when I'm in situations like that.
Take a microfiber towel with you is good.
Yeah. Or a suede type cloth.
Yeah.
They actually soak the water up there, because I never get the blinking thing, so they just smear all the water everywhere.
No, well, if you drape it over the camera, it just stops it going through to the camera. Yeah.
A chamois cloth is actually pretty good, because that tends to not smear as much.
For dust and, not dust, but external stuff, more than anything, one of the things I thoroughly recommend keeping in your camera bag is a paintbrush.
Yeah.
Like a reasonable size paintbrush as well, because if you do something horrible, like you've got the camera and you're fiddling around and suddenly you drop the body onto the sand.
Yeah.
Trying to get that off.
And you don't want to wipe it off.
With your elbow is not really the easiest thing to do. No. But if you've got a big brush, you'd be surprised how quick you can get that off.
You carry a brush around.
It's a 2-inch brush, I think, I carry with me,
But the cold is more of a challenge, I think. So when I was out in Iceland, I had a few problems with the camera playing up. The screen on the back played up a bit, got black pixels on it. Well, and I'm not sure whether that was moisture crystallizing inside the camera or something.
A lot of them are not designed to work in temperatures, you know, greater than minus 6, minus 10 anyway.
Yeah, you were saying that's the sort of operating temperature for electronics.
It is.
Unless you've got a pro camera.
Exactly, and a lot of that is not designed to do things like that. So, and most of them work absolutely fine in like minus 15, minus 20 even, but sometimes when you get to those really cold temperatures, you've got to be pretty careful. You know, you can have pretty nasty things happen to things, like shutters freezing and all sorts of stuff. Mm. So you've got to be pretty careful. I mean, I've shot with, I've got a 1DX and the 6D, which I take with me regularly out to Norway and frozen areas like that. And the two bodies themselves work together really well hand in hand. But the last time when I was out, because it was like minus 30 or something ridiculous, although I use the 6D literally all the time, and the 1DX is the night vision camera, the 1DX was used constantly throughout the whole thing and performed absolutely flawlessly, and even up to temperatures of, like I said, minus 38.
Yeah.
So, all right, that's really, really extreme, and most people are not going to come into and encounter things like that. But with anything like that, firstly, I think, you know, unless you're going to buy pro bodies, then you're not going to get the water protection. Mm. Unless you're going to buy pro bodies, you're not going to get that really ridiculous temperature protection either. But with something like most consumer cameras, I'd recommend A, the Morrison's bag trick, and B, with rubber bands.
Shower cap works as well.
Yeah. Shower caps.
Yeah. Shower cap.
And you buy them in hotel rooms.
Yes. You do, usually free in hotel rooms, yeah. Yeah.
What about cold? I mean, in terms of keeping a bag outside or inside, I mean, to stop things steaming up, what how do you
go? I was in Norway with Tony a few years ago, and I had a problem with frozen condensation inside a lens.
Yeah.
Because I'd been in Tasmania in a temperate rainforest a week earlier.
Right.
Came back with it, and it didn't quite like going from 100% humidity to minus 25.
One of my shutters, the shutter speed went. Shutter speed control locked up.
Right.
It was a bit stiff anyway, but...
Yeah, I mean, I think that's an issue. You need to probably think about making sure that all your gear is thoroughly dry before you take it out into those kind of cold...
People say, obviously, like, put your camera bag in the car. You know, even said put it in the car overnight, but I don't recommend that for insurance reasons.
Yeah.
But on the other side of it, bringing your camera down in temperature is a good idea. Also, not doing the absolute reverse. In other words, just coming home after being out in freezing cold or in, you know, humid or wet conditions.
Yeah.
And just walking straight back in and opening your camera bag up.
Yeah.
And just,
you know, getting moisture inside the camera.
Into your 22-degree hotel room, it just does completely the opposite. So just be careful and sensible about what you do, I guess.
Yeah. Mm.
And dry all the gear down. The biggest thing as well, of course, is seawater and sea spray.
Yeah.
Overall, obviously, you're going to clean that off. Just I always come back, use kitchen roll. Or something on those lines, and just wipe all of the moisture off the camera. Even take the plates, brackets, everything off. It all has to come off. And then, if I've been out in shooting in the sea, of course, I know this is slightly away from temperature, but I always make sure that I've got a Gitzo. I think it's a 4.5-4.3 tripod.
Okay. Yeah.
And I have to break it all down.
Yeah.
And I don't want to break it down because I can't be bothered.
Yeah.
And then I have to, because if I don't, then those aluminium sections swell up and I can't put the legs back together and all these sorts of other disasters happen. I had it once with one tripod, and within 6 months of owning a 5540 Gitzo, I couldn't get all the middle leg sections apart because it all swollen up. So I never, ever let that happen again. So you have to be religious about it. It's equipment, it's expensive. You wouldn't do that and then...
You would not put it all in your car.
Exactly. Yeah, you would make sure that you service everything, and you have to get used to doing it.
Yeah. Out of interest, because I know quite a lot of people are going to Iceland. Can the sand and grit on a beach wreck your camera?
In high winds, yeah.
It wrecks your complexion.
Yeah.
the
worst thing I've found in Iceland is if you go to a waterfall like Dettifoss. Because the water's full of rock flour, very fine ground up lava.
So
all of that spray lands on your camera and people wipe the lens, and basically they're wiping all of that grit on the lens. So yeah, that's probably the worst thing. Not the windblown sand is pretty bad, but if it's that bad, you would really struggle to be out in it.
Yeah.
You would really struggle to be standing out in it.
Yeah.
I mean, there are places on the south coast where it strips the paint off cars on a 1 hour journey.
That was Steve Coleman. Was it Steve Coleman? I think he got stuck out there and his car parked. He went across the bridge. It's really windy.
Yeah.
And realised it was getting dangerous. It smashed his windows.
Right.
And so he parked up at the hotel, passed there.
Yeah.
Left it out overnight, and it was stripped completely to the metal overnight in there. And it was 130 mile an hour wind. Day, which is what happened.
Yeah.
So. Minus 38.
Minus 38. That's a wind chill, isn't it?
There'd be bodies like half.
Right, well, we're going to go through a couple of questions, try and get a bit faster because we are coming up to an hour. I'm sure people don't mind staying, but some people don't want to miss things. When you go out, I'm going to go to this one. Oh, yeah, that's the one. When are we going to see a new book by David Ward?
I think I answered that earlier on, didn't I?
Yes.
When I come
ready.
Up with an idea.
And when are we going to see a book by David Clapp?
No, you're not.
No, you're not.
No, it's bad for business. No, I don't know. What I don't want is a garage full of books.
yeah, that's a problem.
I don't know,
mine have all sold out, but yeah.
Oh, very good for you. But the main thing I think is with a lot of it, it represents quite a large risk. It's quite a large financial risk.
It is.
And it worries.
Unless you can get a publisher to pay for it all.
Yeah, which is a rare thing again these days, isn't it, I suppose? So, you've got an arsenal of books behind you, haven't you? How many have you done?
I've only done two where I wrote the text and did all the photographs.
But you've done others as well.
Yeah, I've done the other light and lamb ones, the working the light and developing vision and style. Yeah. And then other ones were commissioned. Yeah, I did a whole load of guidebooks in the 80s and 90s. Yeah. Oh, but I was learning. They're awful. They're dreadful.
You bought them all back, haven't you, I think?
Well, I burnt them all, yeah. Whenever I find a copy, yeah.
A couple of last questions. We have one from Nigel Williams asking, what are your views on new MF Digital, in particular the Pentax 645Z, which is the 50 megapixel Sony chip, and it's just under 645 ratio, I think. Have any of you used it or likely to use it? I'm looking to purchase it for producing large abstract prints up to 50 by 40 inch. Any thoughts?
I haven't used it.
Neither have I. But I would say that probably it's going to be a pretty remarkable system. I used to have some medium format Pentax lenses that I used to use on a shift adapter with my Canon 1DS3. I absolutely loved the, I think it was an FA35,
yeah.
It was called, and it was absolutely laser sharp. It was a brilliant piece of kit. So it wouldn't surprise me if all of that stuff, system-wise, is still A1. I know people that have shot with a Pentax system recently. In fact, my friend Ollie Wright, who's out in the area right now.
I'll keep on seeing his posts.
He got his hands on a Pentax 645 system, and he was doing nothing but raving about it. So yeah. It
looks very good. It's properly weather sealed. It's a very well-produced camera.
Guy
Aubertin's
got one, hasn't he?
Guy Aubertin is in fact writing the second part of his review of it for the magazine next week, hopefully.
Right.
From what I've seen,
in terms of resolution, it should make the size prints that he's talking about. Yeah.
Yeah, and the sensor, it's a Sony sensor in it. It's the same sensor as in the Hasselblad HD50, I think. I'm not sure. And also the IQ250. And we've tried the IQ250, and it's quite amazing. It's very, very good.
Big dynamic range?
Yeah, it's probably 13 stops, as good as a D800.
Right.
Not quite as much high ISO performance, but it will go up to a pretty decent 400-800.
Okay.
And it'll do long exposures. Mm-hmm. And you get live view, which is great, the live view on it.
Proper live view.
Proper live view, rather than the fake live view, one refresh per second on the IQ280.
Oh, it was awful.
Yeah,
dreadful.
Not very fast. In other words, yes. Now, the question is, would it be better to get the Canon 50 megapixel?
It remains to be seen yet.
Yeah, we don't know yet. But
again, it depends on what system you've got, what you've invested in. If it sounds like he's going down that road, then maybe he's already got Pentax lenses.
Yeah. I'd be very tempted to look at the Canon with tilt lenses, because the one thing the Pentax doesn't do is tilt lenses.
The 24... And all of them are very good. I mean, the 45 and the 90 are slightly longer in the tooth, I would say.
Yeah.
They're still very good lenses.
They are. I wouldn't be surprised if they don't update them in the end. Especially, I think the 45, which is probably the weakest of the remaining two. But the 17, and especially, I can't comment so much on the 17. I've only used it for a commission I did. It was a bizarre one. I had to go into a fountain in the Trocadero Paris and photograph an Omani fishing sailing boat in front of the Eiffel Tower for the Oman government.
That's a commission and a half.
Isn't it? It's really good. And there was a whole fanfare, and there was traditional songs and all this stuff happened. It was really good. It was called Oman El Amer. It was a really fun thing to do. I had to buy these waders and jump into the Trocadero after all of the ceremony had stopped and then photograph all this stuff. So I had to use a 17 TSE to get the balance right between the boat and the Eiffel Tower, because, of course, if the Eiffel Tower stood huge, like it was in the 24 TSE, the boat was tiny, and then it meant that it looked like political dominance was had by by France over Oman, etc. So it was really fun, and I used it then, and it was extremely good. But the 24 TSE in particular is a stellar lens, and I don't doubt that will work flawlessly with 50 megapixels.
The only thing I can think is a potential problem is just the larger format size, isn't it? So, because you're going to have less depth of field, you're going to be on longer lenses. So, that's the only downside I can see, really. So
if you're going to be blowing things up that size and you're doing typical landscape stuff, I'd be looking at movements if possible, if you can.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, just to mention what I've learned this weekend. I mean, I've been shooting 6x9, some 5.4, and some other bits, and I've found straight away that, you know, even with 6.9, that you're backing off from the subject all the time because you just cannot get the depth of field. And all I kept thinking was, I need tilt really badly right now. And then, of course, the only camera that I had, it was a loaner from Tristan. It was a JTC, which is an old architectural camera, which is only designed to do that job.
It's like an Alpha. It just had rise and fall on it.
Yeah, it has rise and fall on it. And I was backing away from the subject all the time. So I would say, yeah, from my own knowledge of medium format digital, I would say that you are always needing to get that movement in somehow, because it makes so much of a difference of the potential of what you can photograph. And you don't want the system to back you away from your creativity.
Yeah. Final question. Is landscape photography getting too exclusive? This is from Dave Varro. There's so much good stuff out there, the new starters feel a bit shut out. May feel shut out, he says.
Getting exclusive, that's an interesting way of... People would say that it's got more inclusive because it's easier to travel, it's easier to technically... The craft element is quicker to learn.
When I see
so you could
like
say that that's more inclusive than it was.
Mark Littlejohn's come along and he's only started in the last 4 years.
Mm.
And he's doing exceptionally well. In fact, we see a lot of photographers who have just picked up 5D2s or 5D3s and all of a sudden taking magnificent.
Does he mean exclusive in the sense that it's harder to make your mark? I don't know.
It could do. If you're feeling shut out...
I think that's probably true now. I doubt in the current era that we will ever have anybody who stands head and shoulders above the crowd like Man Ray did, or Adams, or Cartier-Bresson, or Edward Weston, or even Diane Arbus in the 60s. That's not going to happen because there are too many practitioners, and images are too ubiquitous, really.
Do you think this is why we're getting a bit of an arms race in terms of saturation and heroic shots? Is because everybody's stepping so fast, trying to create better things.
Yeah, except if they're all doing the same thing, then actually there's not much to differentiate between them, is there? You know, if we go back to what I said earlier about that we're quoting from reality, then the only way you can stand out really is for the particularity of your gaze to be discernible.
Yeah.
But that's a hard thing. That's a hard thing to do, and I suppose especially it's a hard thing to do in landscape if your subject is vistas, because they're well known and they're everywhere. And you were talking about earlier that saying that, you know, one of the things you found best about your camera was it had GPS on it.
Mm.
Well, sadly, the problem is that everybody's camera's got GPS on it. Everybody knows where everybody else's picture was taken.
Yeah.
If you want to get into that exclusivity thing, I personally don't think that matters, really. I think... You just have to plough your own furrow. You just have to make images that please you and not think too much about the rest.
Yeah.
I think it comes down back to available time. And it comes back down to the fact being that you want to go and you want to create something that's going to make you have a really great sense of self-worth, that you've managed to capture something that is beautifully painterly or artistic, or, you know, and a lot of those...
And something that pleases you, not setting out to please somebody else.
Exactly. You can go home and show your wife or your family or something and just go, look at what I've managed to create. This is something I've always wanted to do. Look at what I've managed to do. And from that moment onwards, when you've managed to be able to do that, or maybe you shared it online or something, you then become more excited about the idea of doing something else. But it's not down to the fact that, you know, it's not originality. It comes back to the same thing again of, it's the available time that you've got, and there's nothing wrong with that. And I don't think there's ever anything wrong with that. If you are one of the creative, restless people who feels as though that has less of a value, then you will go, all right, I've done that now, I don't need to do that again, because although I've done it, I just feel like, well, it was someone else's, it was everybody's, it's not mine.
That's as much as a curse as a gift, isn't it, then?
Coming back to my friend, Tristan Campbell, I mean, if you look at the stuff that he does, he's got like one square mile that he goes to in I'm not too sure where it is, Paisley Bridge, isn't it?
Near Paisley Bridge,
something like that. He's even abandoning that now, he feels, because he wants to go and look for somewhere else because he's done it for so long. But there you go. I mean, he can easily travel and go to Bolton Abbey or go somewhere else.
Paul Moon up the road, he takes photographs in less than like half a mile square.
There we go.
And he's been doing nothing but that for the last few years.
But that doesn't, usually you turn up, you've got limited time, you've got to get there and you want to get a shot and you want to try and get something that you can look back and remember and feel and make you feel good. But it's exactly the same as I often tell participants and many other people. No one hands you a guitar and says, make something original. You know, you just pick up a song,
play Smoke on the Water,
and then the songs get more intricate and perhaps the locations get more difficult to get to, but you still want to go and play those songs, and why not? Because Monday to Friday, you're stuck doing what you do to earn a living, to sustain your living with your family and many other things. And
yeah,
it becomes such a life-enriching hobby, and it can be such a wonderful thing. And without it, a lot of people will just be there 9 to 5 and then weekend doing what they would do. But now they're out, and now they're enjoying the world, and there's naffle wrong with that, as far as I'm concerned.
Enjoy the world with your camera, basically.
Yeah.
As I said in the Yorkshire accent.
Naffle.
Naffle.
That's brilliant. Well, thank you very much, David, and thank you very much, David.
No, thank you, David.
Yeah. And thank you, David's behind the camera there. And all you Davids at home. that's it for this evening. I'll just remind you about the videos. There is a free video from David Clapp talking at the conference.
Damn you and my commission.
Yes, no money whatsoever, exchanging hands. So go and have a look at it, and if you like it, we have an offer on the videos, 35% off with the code ONLAND50 at streamscape.uk. Take a look,
35.
See what you think. 35% off, ONLAND35. But go to streamscape.uk, go to the page where you signed up for this thing, whatever it is, live broadcast, I suppose. Let us know what you think. If you've got any questions for the next session.
Well, I don't think we're dead anyway, so that's good.
No. One of the things we might be talking about next time is this, which is we all talk about large format. Is large format dead, or is film dead? And we were talking about tilt shift lenses.
Yeah.
And this is a little device I took to Iceland with me, which is a tilt adapters for these new mirrorless cameras, which is one of the things that mirrorless are bringing in. And it allows you to use old style lenses, and this is an old Bronica lens.
That's a proper lens cap, because it's a screw-on lens cap.
You don't get many of those anymore, do you?
No.
you know why? Because it's a pain in the ass.
Yeah.
But I've got this here, and I also, the adapter works on old Canon lenses as well. So I've got an old manual Canon lens.
But it's not an old manual Canon lens, because what's been done to it?
It is a Canon FD lens, which you can't use on many cameras because it's such a small distance. But I've had a chap in Scotland convert it to an EF mount.
What's his name?
Eddie something or other.
That narrows it down.
But I'll
just
be
Google Eddie in Scotland.
Just Google Eddie. There aren't many out there. But we'll be talking about this in the next issue, and also going over it in a little video I took in Iceland. So keep your eyes out for it. And until then, goodbye from me, and goodbye from the Davids.
Cheers.
Goodbye for now.